to the Batmobile. Let's go.
Atomic batteries to power. Turbines to speed.
Roger. Ready to move out.
Welcome back to the basement, motherfuckers. Basement Boy Banter, episode 49. We are one away from 50, my friends. One away from 50. I am Thor. We're back in the basement. Brian has returned mysteriously from parts unknown. Things happened to him that he probably doesn't want to talk about and will haunt him and scar him for the rest of his life. But Brian's back. Brian, hello.
Hello.
Didn't even know he left.
Didn't even know he left. And we have a special guest in the house tonight. Very special guest in the house tonight. Johnny.
Athmann.
I was going there next.
I'm so special that
Johnny Athmann.
Forgot.
I did not forget. I was going there. You didn't even get me. I was dramatic pause before the last name.
Usually you go Johnny Athmann.
You hit the Athmann? I'd hit the Johnny Athmann.
Oh, then.
You know?
I'm like, hi, friends. How are you doing?
Is that like putting the, when you say fuck, instead of like fuck, being more like fka?
It's more like a
Yeah, that too.
Get rid of the U. Who needs vowels?
Fuck vowels. If anyone knows anything about me, they know I say fuck vowels.
Yeah.
Pretty much. Yeah, this show's going to be a good show tonight. I'm telling you, you guys tuned in for a special one. We're Basement Boy Banter, recapping the weekend nerd. It's what we do here. So let's go right into it real quick. X-Men dropped a new trailer, number 2, I believe. X-Men trailer number 2.
Yeah.
We got some shots that I liked. There was a bunch of shit in there that I was digging. We got Angel before he has the metal wings fighting Nightcrawler, which it looks like in that cage type thing.
Mm-hmm.
We got Olivia Munn cutting the car in half and her cleavage flying into the forecourt or the, you know, the front of the screen. That was still my favorite part of any trailer I've seen all year. And what else do we get? I'm lost on cleavage, so Brian, go.
I don't think there was anything that I was like, oh, this is new and exciting. I just kind of liked the way the trailer was set up, and I don't know. It felt like there was most of the shots we've already seen. Maybe not all, but, you know, like, I'd say at least 50%. But at the same time, they're cut a little different, so it felt new. I like the way this, I mean, I like the other trailer, but the way this one was put together, I think it, if this was the only trailer you saw, I think it would be better than if the only trailer you saw was the first one, for sure.
That makes sense.
Now, that's the first time I've seen either trailer.
Any trailer for X-Men Apocalypse?
Correct. Okay. And now, I'm not really, like, privy to a lot. I mean, I know X-Men. I watched the cartoon growing up. I know, like, the main characters, obviously Wolverine, you know, Cyclops, etc. But this trailer made me kind of confused in the sense that it almost felt like they're combining, like, a different world. So I thought there was more, like, alien life than mutant life. So it was less, like, humanoid, like, mutants. And I felt like it was more sometimes part Star Wars.
Well, Apocalypse himself kind of looks almost alien-ish to a certain extent. The main bad guy.
Yeah.
And there was, I mean, it's, the movie takes place in the 80s, so it's got a lot of 80s vibe to it a little bit, for something like how the characters look
like
and stuff
like
that.
Honestly, I felt like the 80s vibe was, it didn't feel like, I don't know if you guys ever watched Regular Show, but that feels 80s.
Did you just say, you ever watch Regular Show? Come on now. Who you
but that
to?
Feels 80s. Like, I'm watching it, and I'm like, it feels like we're in the 80s. This felt like they're saying the 80s existed and they know what happened in the 80s.
Well, it didn't look like the 80s.
Right,
because, like,
that's
it was
what
too
I mean.
Clean.
That's
like,
what I mean.
Yeah, the production value was not 80s.
Too high. Yeah, it's too high of a production value. But I'm curious to see this movie. Like, because there's a lot of talks of, is this going to be like the final X-Men movie as we know it? And they're just going to, like, reboot X-Men? Or what they're going to do? Because now you have Deadpool, who's just a mammoth. I mean, they over $700 million worldwide. One of the highest grossing superhero movies domestically ever.
Oh, an R-rated.
R-rated. I mean, it was just a phenomenal movie, but now they got that, and that's a Fox property, so they want to push that, but that takes place now.
Mm-hmm.
And they're in the 80s with their X-Men stuff. So you're, what, you're going to jump to the 90s for the next one, then 2000, so three X-Men movies from now, Deadpool can show up? I don't think Fox wants to do that.
I'm betting this is the last...
prequel?
Right. Because, I mean, do you really need another one after this? Because this is going to set up...
It depends.
If you think about it, this is going to set up all your future, your main roster X-Men, because they'll be the rookies in this, essentially.
Yeah.
But it'll also kind of... be like, okay, these were the old X-Men, and then bring you in when you see the old people. So I really don't, and they're using a big villain to kind of do the segue. I think
it'll be interesting.
They
to
really
see,
don't need another one.
It'll be interesting to see where they leave it at the end of Apocalypse. Yeah. Like where the story ends at Apocalypse will be very interesting as to where the X-Men universe is going from that point on. I think. I mean, they'd be stupid not to. They really would be, because if you look at like, well, then let's just moving on from there. Like Civil War, they're gonna have three post-credit scenes. So like Marvel's got a plan in action of like what's coming next. Like they're much more thought out than Fox, obviously. So what do you guys think about that? There could be as many as three post-credit scenes for Civil War, which comes out in like 2 months.
I think that's like
excessive.
At least too many. Well, I don't mind post-credit scenes, but I hate like end credit scenes, because it's like I'd rather just look it up on YouTube. I'm not gonna sit there for that.
They have to do something with Doctor Strange, because they just have to get the awareness out there for Doctor Strange, and it's the next movie to come out in November. They have to kind of tell where the story is going next, and they also have to technically kind of set up Infinity War,
right? But that's exactly my point. Two of those they could do in the movie near the end. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
They really only need a Doctor Strange one, which, again, technically you could do in the movie, but that's the only one that's kind of like, okay, you know, it would feel kind of forced in this movie with 1,000 heroes to be like, oh, yeah, Doctor Strange. Yeah. So that makes a little more sense. But the other two are kind of like, the movie should tell me where the next movie is going. You know what I mean? I shouldn't need... necessarily, and it's not like
look at the Ant-Man post-credit scene where they had Bucky trapped in the vice or whatever, and he's like, let's call Tony. He's like, no, I know a guy, and that's when Ant-Man shows up in Civil War, we're assuming. So what do you think Johnny, about some of the, like, three post-credit scenes in a movie?
I think only like the more privy people who are into like the comic book aspect of it, rather than just like the spectacle, would even stay past the credits or even give a shit.
That's true.
It's sort of like, I feel like if they were to put like an Easter egg within the film, that might set it up a little bit better, because people would geek out a little bit more about the idea of like, oh, did you see this? And then like it would get press, like, let's say, you know, people in the background or whatever, but after the credits, it's kind of more obvious as to where they're going to go, because it leaves like that mystery or like the anticipation of like, what are they going to do with this next?
Right.
Well, and I totally agree with him on the in the movie people. It's just like when Chris talked about in Deadpool, the helicarrier, you do something that subtle, but people totally pick up on it and then they go nuts. It's the difference between being like, oh, did you wait the extra 5 minutes to see that obvious thing?
More like 10, but yeah.
Or did you pick out this minuscule detail in the background that, like, you really had to be paying attention to notice?
I mean, they did that a lot with the last Batman with Christian Bale, whereas you could see, like, the Superman, Batman logo in the background, et cetera. There's Easter eggs as into, like, this is going to progress. It's just, it's going to go in a different direction.
Right.
Like, the Justice League is going to be put together, et cetera.
Well, there's a lot of Easter eggs in Man of Steel with, like, the Wayne Tech stuff.
Yeah, and I've always liked that better, is, like, the sneaky Easter eggs in the movie versus after credit scenes. Because it's, like, the sneaky end credit stuff, or sneaky during the movie stuff, is more fun.
Yeah.
The Easter eggs are fun to find. Where you just put it on a platter and give me the Easter egg.
They're fun to find, and then if you don't find them, there's always people who make big lists on YouTube about all the Easter eggs they found, and then you feel like so excited when you hear about it, and then you tell your friends, and then it gives you that conversation piece. Whereas the end credits, I feel like the conversation is pretty short about it, because they're usually pretty straightforward.
Not only that, but it's also it's a what I equate to like hidden levels in a video game or something like that. It's like, it's not necessary. You can go linear, you can go all the way through. Like the original Batman series, like when Tim Burton did it, and then they did Batman Forever, etc. It was just a straight story, encapsulated, you know. It didn't make references to the last show, didn't make references to what might come, or even the Batman universe. And I hate to just divert to Batman, but I know a lot about
Batman's universe. An easy one to go, yeah.
Yeah, but I mean, it's sort of like the idea of, you know, the writers know the lore, they know the story, if they're already, like, thinking ahead, or doing callbacks to earlier movies.
Right.
So, and I don't know.
I honestly, you know how you said, like, the comic book people are the only people who are going to care for end credit scenes? I honestly feel like it's the opposite. Because, I mean, being in the theater, the
people.
It's like all the people who just sat in credits, there were always the same people who were just like, I got 20 minutes to kill to see this spoon-fed thing. Whereas, like, the crazy hardcore nerds are the ones who are like, oh my gosh, did you pick that out? And the, you know what I mean? It feels like it's given, it's like a little treat for people who are paying attention to see the movie six times, you know?
Not only that, but it's sort of like the Avengers, you know, movies, whereas when they did the individual characters, there's callbacks to those specific movies when the Avengers are all together. Mm-hmm. So when you actually go back and watch Thor, let's say, you get, like, some reference from Loki that you wouldn't have necessarily got in the Avengers movies, but, like, you watch it and, like, oh, okay,
that's
I got
what he
it.
Was talking about. Yeah. Yep. Good pickup with Thor, by the way. Like that one.
Oh, I know. I figured he would.
You know, it's never a bad idea to go there on this show. So let's talk, let's just get it out of the way, because I don't even know how either one of you feel, but I know how I feel about this. Indiana Jones 5 was announced. That it's going to happen, and it's not going to be Chris Pratt or Chris Pine or anybody else who we thought was going to maybe take the mantle of Indiana Jones. It's going to be Harrison Ford.
Yeah, he said he wouldn't do a fifth sequel if Harrison wasn't in on it.
Yep. So Spielberg and Ford are back. And then I just read an article, I think today, that the writer from the Crystal Skull is also returning.
Ouch.
That was my face I made when I
might not
that.
Be the best choice.
Right? So, okay, we all know the first three.
Is Shia LaBeouf?
No, I hope not. But we got the
first...
Let's
bring back Sean Connery.
Yes. He doesn't do movies anymore. Ever since League of Extraordinary Gentlemen, he's like, No, thank you.
Let's not even get into that.
I know, right? Okay, so the first three Indiana Jones classics. The fourth one, I'm going to be 100% honest right now. I've seen all of 10 minutes of that movie. But all you need to know is Indiana Jones hides from a nuclear explosion.
In a refrigerator?
Fucking right. A goddamn refrigerator.
Well, it's just like those Cold War ads in the 80s. Just duck and cover. You're fine. That wooden desk, it'll hide you from a nuclear explosion.
Are you telling me hiding under a wooden desk in the school is not going to protect me from a nuclear
explosion? I'm telling you exactly what the government doesn't want you to know.
Wow. Mind blown.
I know.
Mind blown.
See, Indiana Jones is a topic you really shouldn't bring up on the show, because I could talk forever.
Let's
number
hear
one.
Indy.
I love the Indiana Jones series.
Me too.
So much.
Except
but
for
I
the
think
fourth one.
The fourth one, it's not great. It's but not. I think there's good parts to it, and I think people give too much credit to the first three, especially that refrigerator scene. Yeah, it's stupid. But do you remember in Temple of Doom when they fell off a waterfall and they fell out of a plane and then off a giant waterfall
and they rolled
in a raft?
In the rubber boat. Hell yeah,
but
that's legit.
So much more believable than surviving a nuclear explosion in a lead-lined fridge. It's like they're both... When you watch Indiana Jones, you suspend...
suspend disbelief when you watch movies. Yes, you set up... If a movie universe sets their parameters as to what... You know, level of disbelief they're setting, then yes, to that level you have to, you know, suspend disbelief. So I almost think the nuclear explosion goes beyond that slightly. Although the analogy to the rubber boat, not bad.
And it's one of those things where it's like, I get it. It's dumb. That's why we don't like it. It's not because it's unbelievable. It's because it's not fun, interesting, cool. It's not indie, you know? Like... Being quick and smart and pulling that and doing some cool action scene feels Indiana Jones. Hiding in a fridge does not.
He was never really that tough, or he was just clever.
That's what I mean.
Yeah.
But the raft feels way more clever than the refrigerator, because it feels like he's just hiding. And
I think Harrison Ford is trying to define himself as indestructible, i.e. his jumping out of that sewer and into a waterfall in The Fugitive. he can't die.
And
water's his friend.
I want to argue the point of Shia LaBeouf. Yeah. He is actually one of the few good things in that movie, actually. He would actually take that mantle if his performance in that movie, the only good scene is when him and Harrison Ford are like bantering. They go on the motorcycle. Best scene of the whole movie.
Like I said, I've seen 10 minutes of this movie, so I'm not the best judge of any of it.
He does a decent job. I think they just, number one, throw him near the end into a category of we got to give him something to do, so they give him like dumb stuff to do. And number two, the movie kind of falls in on itself near the end, but the beginning, when it's those two, it's actually not that bad.
Do you think it would have been better if he would have had the paper bag over his head like he did on the red carpets at the Academy Awards?
No, I think he was good the way he was. Honestly, he played the greaser pretty well.
Maybe I'll actually watch the movie so I can give it.
We're not
even talking about Indy 4, Indy 5.
Well, this leads into Indy 5.
Okay, well then let's get there.
I think if they set it up like Indy 4 should have been set up and was set up in the beginning, where Harrison is not there to be Indiana Jones the whole movie, but he's there to pass the mantle on, it could be good. Because that's where Indy 4 fell off the rails. First half, they're setting it up like, it's Shia LaBeouf's job now. But then the last half, they're like, actually, Harrison Ford's awesome. We're not going to give it to him. So it ruins it because it's not Shia LaBeouf.
There's a setup and no payoff.
It'd be like if in Creed, he lost like halfway through the movie, and then Rocky comes in and makes like a revenge fight.
Okay.
You would be like, "This is awful."
That would be horrible.
Exactly, but instead they have him do it.
That would be sheer narcissism on Sly's part.
But that's what I mean. I think that's the biggest fail with 4, and 5 could make up for that. And I mean, yeah, the aliens and other stuff is stupid, but it's one of those things where that's at the core of the movie. That's not what killed it. That's just an annoying part that adds to the fact that the movie's not good.
It's just a thing that everyone points out. But it's not. There's a lot more to like why that movie didn't succeed the way it could have.
I mean, I think it's the same way that they fucked up the Transformers. Like, I mean, from the beginning, it was just really a lot. They turned it into just flash and awe rather than plot and like character development.
There's no substance.
Yeah,
Transformers movies are... There's one's all right. Three's.
I feel like we come to Transformers a lot
too often because it's fucking 4 was just 4 is one of the worst movies ever.
I couldn't watch beyond 1, and I didn't even give Michael Bay's Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles a shot.
Okay, he didn't actually. Surprisingly, Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles is solid because he's a producer. He didn't direct or do anything. He just throws his name.
It's not like it's the best Ninja Turtles movie ever. It's not the best Ninja Turtles movie,
but it's not bad either.
Is Corey Feldman involved?
No.
Then I'm out.
then I'm out. All right. I don't even know anymore. I don't know. Something. Things.
Stuff.
Let's go. R-rated Spawn movie is happening. I think we mentioned this like 2 weeks ago or a week ago. I think we talked about it. I remember saying something about Spawn at some point to somebody. It could have been on here. Could have been in the hot tub at the gym. I have no fucking clue. But that's neither here nor there at this point. There is going to be a Spawn R-rated movie.
Do you think that's tantamount to Deadpool succeeding being an R?
Definitely.
Okay.
I think there's a direct correlation there.
I think it's a twofold. Number one, Deadpool. I'd say that's the strongest factor.
Right.
But number two, if you look at Spawn as a character and the movie he was, you know, the Spawn movie that's not good, it's not the character. You know what I mean? You can tell directly that it was technology, bad choices. So it's one of those characters, and this is what I wish they would do more with remakes.
But they're talking about making the Spawn not even Spawn. Like, he's more of almost like a specter. He's not like Spawn, like...
I'd have to see what they do.
I know, it makes me nervous. Because Todd McFarlane was a genius at one point. But then they kind of get in their own heads almost too much. You know what I mean? Uh-huh. And then when you have total control...
That's the worst about it.
Certain things scare me.
Like, when directors have total control, it really starts getting rough.
Yeah,
because people are scared to tell them that's a dumb idea.
I.e. Star Wars prequels. I mean, that's your best example right there. Lucas was a genius in the first ones because he had Kazan and everybody else telling him, yo, man, probably wouldn't do that. Like, maybe don't go that route.
But when people are, like, nervous to be like, when you got all
yes
idea.
Men and it's just like, yeah, dude, that's a great idea. Best thing I've ever heard. Yes, make everything cool. Shiny. Shoot everything in front of a green screen. This is awesome.
Well, not only that, but, like, redoing the original three
episodes. Oh, special editions?
Yeah.
Oh.
I mean, it was just like he couldn't let go. He's like the quarterback from high school who scored 4 touchdowns in 1 game. He's going to reference it for the rest of his life, so he just couldn't let that
property go. I met that dude at the bar on St. Patty's Day, and he had to tell me about that 4-touchdown game again.
You met Al Bundy?
Just the other day.
It's worse than that, though. It's like it would be like if that quarterback had a tape of it, made you watch it, but kept changing it so it looked more and more epic every time you watched it. You know, watched it 6 times, man.
The 10-yard pass becomes an 80-yard pass.
You know? And then he puts in, like,
wait a minute, what?
300-pound defensive linemen, and they're all
blitzing. I thought you were going to say Lions. I was like, that would actually be sweet.
He runs for, like, 200 yards in the game off one scramble that he's been editing.
He just relives Forrest Gump running to get a touchdown.
That's awesome. He just cuts that right in. It's not even a good edit either.
It wasn't even a pass, it was a pure QB sneak.
Yep. All the way for the touchdown. Oh, that's good stuff. That is good stuff. What are we talking about?
Spawn.
Oh, yeah. Right.
Could be good, but
I don't know.
We're going to need to.
I think they're riding that whole tide of just like, oh, what other, you know, superheroes, what other comic book characters can we do? And, like, I mean, they blew that, I think, with Green Lantern. Ryan Reynolds, and he won his way back with Deadpool.
Redemption.
See, I feel like Spawn's a little different, though, because they're remaking a character that didn't hit. You know, there's already a Spawn movie.
Well, they're remaking Green Lantern.
And I'd rather they do that than be like, let's pull somebody else. Spawn's completely worthless now because he's tied to a bad movie.
Yeah, but I mean, the first two Spider-Man with Tobey Maguire, like, those were good. The third one was garbage, but like then they revamped it or rebooted it, and then that
Andrew
was
Garfield.
But shit.
Yeah. See, that's the problem. Just,
they tried
the
to make
first,
it dark.
The first one was all right. I like the first Amazing Spider-Man. The second one, that's complete trash.
They're not bad. They're not to Spawn levels of bad.
You know what's funny though is every movie I say is complete trash, I own on DVD.
Well, you know,
I have horrible.
But those are like he's more of a whimsical character, whereas Batman, when you know. Christopher Nolan made it dark, like he's the Dark Knight, so it made sense that it was tonally, like, appropriate.
Well, that's why when you look at the new Spider-Man from Civil War trailer, like, it was so good because he was like, it was bright again, and it was like bright red and blue costume, and it was like, hey guys, like, that 5 seconds of Spidey felt more like Spidey than anything we've gotten in the past.
Yeah,
so, in a long time.
Was that not mopey? Thank goodness. I mean, I get it.
And he could be in the movie. Who knows?
Let's hope not. I get it. Yeah. His uncle died or whatever, character-wise. But they make, like, his character is constantly sad.
Yeah.
But the Broadway play, though, that represented the comic perfectly, right?
I have no idea.
Oh, I think 4 different Spider-Men they were, like, pretty tragically injured during rehearsals.
Really?
They were going to try to do a Broadway play of Spider-Man? That's awesome.
That was about 3 or 4 years ago.
That's
horrible
idea.
Wasn't that called, like, something dark? Something dark?
I don't know what it was called.
After dark?
We can Google it or Bing it or something.
Yeah.
Bing it. Or we in Twilight?
We could AOL it. Who knows?
And technically Spider-Man, the Andrew Garfield one, he uses Bing. The first movie, the second movie, he comes over to Google.
Really?
Yeah.
That's funny. Microsoft didn't want to shell any money.
Yeah, they're like, it's pointless. No one uses
Google's
Bing
like,
anyway.
We got that Google money. We got you.
Yeah.
Where did this start at?
Oh, we were talking about Spawn.
Was this Spawn? Is this still Spawn?
Maybe we should move on.
All right, maybe we should. I mean, Luke Cage teaser. We watched that, and there was a logo, which will go right... Thank you, Thor. I give myself cues for where to put pictures now because I make it easy on myself. Luke Cage. We got the logo and we got a bunch of people shooting him and him saying he's sick and tired of buying new clothes.
Mm-hmm.
It was 22 seconds.
I'm not familiar with the character, to be honest.
Okay, so Power Man, let's just break this down super simply for how they have it in Jessica Jones.
Was that the sequel to the Power Glove for Nintendo?
Nope, he's got... Oh, I wish. That would have been much better. But so Luke Cage, or Power Man, as he's referred to sometimes, has indestructible skin. Okay. So he like he can't be burned, shot. Like
is his strength is a power too, or is that just he's got a lot
of strength, but it's not. Jessica Jones is stronger than Luke Cage. It's more of his indestructibility that's his superpower. Mm-hmm. How did he get it in Jessica Jones? Did he explain how he got the power in Jessica Jones? Okay, yeah. So they haven't explained that yet.
Unless I forgot.
No, I'm not recalling it either. So I'm not thinking so. Because if you didn't recall it and I didn't recall it, then it probably didn't happen. If you recall it and I didn't, then it probably did happen. That's how I go with things these days. My mind's stretched thin.
He's basically...
Luke Cage, yeah, thank you.
Well, I was going to say he's got like a superpower that it makes him impenetrable, so to speak, but he doesn't have like super strength, i.e. he's similar to Wolverine, where Wolverine, you know, what, rehabilitates very quickly, etc.
Yeah.
But like his only superpower is his adamantium claws, but he's fighting against... a villain, Magneto, who can manipulate metal, so he's pointless.
Right. No, Luke Cage, his power set's different, because you're right, it does put him in a weird spot, where it's like, how many times can he get shot at or burned, or how much can they do with that power set, because he doesn't have like a strength or anything besides that. So it'll be interesting to see how they utilize the characters.
Yeah, but I kind of like it because, I mean, Daredevil, technically, his only power is...
He doesn't have any. Oh, he's blind.
His senses, you know, his super senses. But at the same time, I kind of like all of these characters. It's like they're little pieces of Superman that are, like, you know, separated. It's like super strength, indestructible skin, really super good senses. But I like the limitation they have there. But then they can make it work. You know what I mean? He's got indestructible skin, but they've also already shown that he can still die.
I think you're selling Daredevil short because he also, at that time, had the super ability to fuck Jennifer Lopez.
I mean, I don't know if that's a superpower as much
as... Yeah, I mean, there's been a lot of people who have ridden that train. Because we're not going to call Casper superpowered. He, I think, is still banging out J-Lo. I'm not really sure.
But that was in her prime.
That was. That was before the... That's before that Diddy before ruined Geely. Her. That was before Diddy ruined her.
Yeah, he kind of did.
Diddy ruined J-Lo. I'm sorry.
And then he changed his name.
Yep.
He didn't want to be responsible.
He didn't. He was like, I'm not... I can't co-sign that, right? No, he was... I can't pay child support. I got Diddy money.
Yeah, he does.
You know what? Since Brian brought him up, Daredevil, season 2. It dropped 2 days ago, yesterday. What's today? Saturday? Yesterday. Friday. Yesterday. I got to watch some. Brian got to watch a little bit more. We're going to talk about just the first 2 episodes this week. So, a little spoiler alert. If you haven't watched the first 2 episodes of season 2 of Daredevil, fast forward about 5 minutes. We should be over it by then. If you have, enjoy. And then we will cover the rest of season 2 next week. We're both going to finish it this week. I already got time blocked out for it. And I got a 3-day weekend next weekend. So I'll get it finished before we shoot another episode. Episode 50. I'm excited for episode 50. I got a couple of plans for episode 50, people. I can't say anything yet. Just wait on it. Daredevil, start us off.
You're going to have to finish this off, too, because I don't know shit about Daredevil.
Okay. Brian?
It starts off pretty quicker, I'll say.
Yes.
Than the other
yes,
one.
Yes, it does.
The first season, it felt like... I mean, there's still the fighting and whatever, but it felt like they built to Kingpin and how awesome he is slower. Whereas I feel like they're blowing their load on Punisher really fast.
Well, I think... Because I think they have to get through it because the second half of is probably going to be the Hand and Elektra. And they have to get to that part. They have to get to that. So there's more into it.
Mm-hmm.
You know? Because I'm through episode 2, right? Mm-hmm. So first episode, I thought very well, like, set the story quick.
Right,
like,
yeah.
you're right back in it. Because you know who everybody is now. You don't have to establish who people are, what's going on.
Well, and even if you don't, like, you jump Netflix right has, it. Like, when I Recaps. Started it, it did a recap thing.
Yep.
And it's basically like imagine, you know, like on Dragon Ball Z, the beginning part where it's like, last time
on Dragon Ball
Except
Z.
Except for it's like however many, you know, like, and it's a recap of the entire first season super fast. It's just blam, 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 blam. And I skipped it, but... I mean, the first beginning part, because I watched a tiny bit of it. And I mean, it was... If you hadn't watched the first season, you really...
It'll catch you up right there.
You should, because it's cool. But at the same time, You don't have to enjoy the second season. No. You could literally just watch that recap and then jump right in.
And they're pretty disconnected. I will say the in that first episode, when at the end, when Punisher just shoots him in the head and he falls off the building, and you're like, episode just ends right there. You're like, oh, this like shit's real, real fast. Like, they're not playing. Like, mm-hmm. although in the second episode, you're like, yeah, that he gave you a warning shot because it was like perfect placement, which shows how good Frank Castle is. And then at the end of episode two, he steals Daredevil. Like, he takes him. And I was like, so that's where I'm at right now. Literally, I ended on he was taking Daredevil. And I was like, I got to go to bed. I literally can't do another episode right now. And then it was,
You got, like, two more episodes to really get into Daredevil.
Yeah?
Yeah, that's...
I'm already falling into it.
Like, they like, cover more of him.
Yeah. Of Castle, you mean?
Yeah.
Of, like, Punisher?
Yeah, I mean, they don't do full, like, he had his own TV show cover him, but they give you, I mean, watching it, knowing who he is.
They start to do the character development a little bit more?
Right. Yeah. It goes from he's just some crazy vigilante killer to, like, you learn about him.
The thought process behind it. And that's what I figured. Because, yeah, you're right. In the first two episodes, they pretty much paint him as, like, this murdering vigilante. Yeah,
they set him up perfect. Like, he could be the villain. Yeah. It's awesome.
Well, it's really weird, too, how he just... No, some of that... When they... that picture... one of the shots in... I think it was the first episode. Through the skull. Like, through the head of the dude. And then they backed out, I think, through his skull and then panned out. I can't remember.
Was that when the cops were...
Yeah, the cops were talking.
That wasn't a guy's head, right? That was... I thought that was, like, through his shoulder.
Or through his body.
Yeah, through his whole body.
Something like that. But it was weird how they, like... It's weird how dark it is getting to a certain extent.
Mm-hmm. Can I ask a related two-part question? Would you say, since you brought up Punisher, most tragic movie portrayals?
Mm-hmm.
Like, that's an awesome character, and I think they've blown it every time.
Yep.
And as well as Ghost Rider.
Yep.
And I don't dislike Nick Cage, but...
I'm with you.
Holy crap, that...
Those movies
made
no sense. Yes. Those movies have sucked.
And those are two franchises I wanted
I honestly think all of those movies, they're not good, but they're fun to watch. They're more like guilty pleasure
yeah. comic book movies, I'd say.
They're more like cult films.
We are getting to the point of like guilty pleasure comic book movies versus good comic book movies versus just like everything else. But to what you're saying is they haven't done any of those characters right, which is why I think Netflix is the best vehicle
for
the characters like that. And they are talking about doing a Punisher and a Ghost Rider series.
That's what I was going to ask. Do you think that the next like reliving or revamping of those would best be on TV?
Yeah.
Because that's
not
what
TV, but Netflix specifically. Yeah, like, The streaming services, because
not in a movie medium, but more of a streaming
medium. Well, I could almost guarantee
where
that.
Where you get 13 episodes, 12, 13 episodes, and it gives you more time with these characters, these lesser known characters that I think you need. And their stories are smaller. It's more, the Avengers take the world stuff, but these are like the streets.
Yeah.
And I love that about the Netflix series. And even two episodes in, Daredevil's off to an awesome season two. Like, I am so pumped for, and Nick Cage looks good. Like, I'm so pumped for what Netflix has coming. Oh, speaking of Netflix, Danny Rand confirmed is going to be that Finn dude. Finn Jones. Did I write it down? I wrote it down somewhere. I did, but I just wrote Iron Fist confirmed. I didn't write
his
name.
Iron Fist confirmed.
It was Finn Jones or Jones Finn. It was one of those two. I think Finn Jones. We're going to go with Finn Jones. Yeah. It was Finn Jones. So we screwed up the first time.
Wait.
We got it right the second time.
Is he related to Jessica?
No. Ah, good one. Confirmed. The white dude is playing the white dude that knows karate. Right?
Mm-hmm.
That's what we're leaving right
there.
And if
we're wrong, just bing it and let us know.
Yeah. No, they will. They tell me I'm wrong all the time.
Great. We don't mind it.
Or when I'm right. WrestleMania predictions. I don't have any yet, but I will. WrestleMania predictions will come. Maybe the week before we'll do WrestleMania predictions. Which
you will. I'll feign guesses, but you'll be right.
Mostly, I was right last year. I mean, a blind squirrel finds a nut every now and again. I mean, realistically.
I got in a little bit of shit last night. I was doing a show in a small town, and someone was talking about small town, and someone was talking outside on the patio about oh, I saw a blue jay and a robin. And I was like, and I just jokingly said, wow, bird sighting is like what's entertaining in this town. I was like, how do you feel about seeing squirrels? And they're like, oh, I love squirrels. And I go,
oh, God.
And I go, have you seen any albino squirrels? And it's like, oh, I love albino squirrels. I'm like, oh, so you like the white squirrels more. And some drunk dude wanted to beat the living hell out of me.
He's really?
Like, you just think that about a small town. We're a bunch of racist hillbilly. I'm like,
oh my God.
I'm just being a comic. I'm just being silly.
I love that.
Yeah. That is awesome. People, don't be so fucking sensitive.
There was an albino squirrel that lived near me that was like famous. Really? Like mm-hmm. I talked about it one day, like, cause this was like back when I was going to like high school and stuff. And I was like, it's that albino squirrel. And like everybody who lived in that area knew about that fucking albino squirrel. Mm-hmm. Because everyone would see him running across the road all the time.
Mm-hmm.
I think he's dead because I haven't seen him in a long time.
Brian killed him with his car, people.
Hey, white lives matter, all right? White, even albinos.
White squirrels.
White squirrel. White squirrel lives matter. So yeah, that... what were we talking about? Oh, we weren't talking about anything. We were
talking about WrestleMania,
but... Oh, no, kind of. We were talking about predictions for later. Rogue One, real quick, some Star Wars news. Haven't really had any in a couple weeks, I feel. I've been lacking on the Star Wars news stuff.
Well, I think it's good to give people a breather.
There was so much Star Wars leading up to Force Awakens. Ah, Force Awakens. Memories. Rogue One is coming out in December. But before that we get to there, Marvel's going to have a miniseries, three parts, with a one-shot. So pretty much 3.5 comics, if you know what a one-shot is. Leading up to Rogue One, kind of introducing you to, I think, who the characters are and stuff like that. Because we'll know who everyone's playing by that point. But where's the fucking trailer? I mean, seriously. Let me just hold on. It's great you're making a fucking miniseries. I'm super happy. I'll probably buy it and read it because, you know, I have nothing going on in my life. But can you drop the fucking trailer, please? I mean, we've already had, at this point, we'd had 2 Star Wars The Force Awakens trailers, I believe, at this point last year. We had the one in November the year before, and then we had the one that came out at Celebration.
But the difference like the good is one. They need to give us that breather. The same reason
no, we're... No, but they we, don't, because it's fresh in our minds, and nobody knows what the fuck Star Wars, Rogue One, a Star Wars story is.
Right, but let how me, long hold do on, they
let,
have?
Let me, Johnny, do you know what Rogue One, a Star Wars story is?
Nope. It would probably help if there was a trailer.
You know, you don't have to be on point. This team.
This is my point.
Hey, giving us 5 minutes of no Star Wars is fine. Then you can bring me back full throttle.
It's a horrible idea. You got it fresh in people's mind. Let them know that there's a movie coming out
this
year.
They're going to forget about Star Wars in a couple months. Jesus Christ.
Although, you know, to your point, they are probably trying to get far enough away from The Force Awakens, since Rogue One has nothing to do with The Force Awakens, where people aren't confused as to, wait, does this have anything to do with the movie I just watched like 2 months ago? So to your point, Brian, you are correct.
Kind of. So I'm right. We need a breather. Oh,
a little bit. I mean, we'll just put it out next week. We've had enough of a breather.
We had like an 8-year breather, didn't we?
Yeah, we had a lot.
Which
yeah.
explains why they were just cramming it down our throat forever.
Oh, we did. It was Star Wars heavy all fall. We were Star Wars every week. We had to read books.
And you and I, we could do Star Wars 24/7 every day of the week.
I can.
But your average movie-going audience needs a little breather time. Otherwise, they're like, wait, so what's
going on? It's oversaturated.
I want to watch. Exactly. I want to watch Empire Strikes Back. That's a side note. Myself.
That's what he's doing on.
He's gonna
Wednesday.
Hear it when he's editing and be like, "Oh yeah,
I am." No, literally, I leave notes for myself in the episodes. People, if you want to know what I'm going on, just watch my episodes and you can figure out what
insert
I'm up to.
Image of Empire Strikes Back now.
Nice. He's picking this up quick. He could take my job soon. Let's go.
I really don't think I could.
My job's not hard. Rebels, no. Oh, real quick, before Rebels. Hot Toys has a Hawkman coming out with a fucking Ant-Man on the arrow.
Oh, like, nice.
Oh, it's so Wait. Fucking good. Like, for
Ant-Man with Hawkeye.
Hawkeye.
I think you said... Did he say
he
Hawkman?
He said Hawkman, but yeah.
Hawkeye.
I said
knew
Hawkman?
What he, yeah, I knew
really?
What he was saying. Because
at first I was
yeah.
like, wait, I thought it was a Hawkeye toy. And
okay,
then
so
I thought it was a guy who just really had to spit a
Hot
lot.
Toys Hawkeye
just Hawkeye
has an Ant-Man on his arrow for the Civil War character mm-hmm. for Hot Toys. I was super pumped about that. So that's a side note. Lobo. You know who Lobo is?
No.
You know who Lobo is?
I think so. Is he that... Motorcycle riding
he
alien.
Is. He is.
I love Lobo.
He is. Lobo is the shit. A Lobo movie is back on track over at Warner Brothers.
Oh, boy.
They got the writer from Wonder Woman to write the screenplay for it, which I think is an interesting choice. There's rumors of it being rated R. Lobo is a... How do I put this? He's pretty much like not a mercenary.
He's a bounty hunter from space. Yeah.
He's a space bounty hunter. And he's like... He looks like an 80s biker. So he's got like the handlebar mustache. And then he's got like the goatee.
And he rides like a space bike.
And he rides like a space motorcycle.
So it's like Sons of Anarchy in like 50 years?
Yes. Yes.
Yeah.
Pretty much. I wish. Pretty much. Hopefully. God, that would be amazing.
I'm blanking on his name, but the guy who played Hellboy.
Ron Perlman.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's what I'm imagining.
They're not going to. No, I know. They should really cast him for Lobo.
He'd be a good fucking Lobo. He's a little old, but damn, he'd be a good Lobo. He would. Dang it. All right, but I'm excited for that. I like that. Crow remake is dead.
Thank God, by the way.
Right? It's died like 4 times.
The fucking sequels they've done drove me nuts. Because, come on. Well, this is Brandon Lee, for fuck's sake.
This is going to be a full reboot. Like, they were going to full reboot the movie.
I guess. But no, Sting did that in, 1996.
Yeah. No, he did. He played that. He was up in the rafters. He was the reboot. He was. Stinger. Wow. Oh, you know what? You set it up perfectly. Going to WWE Minute, Sting's retired.
Segway.
Sting's retired from in-ring wrestling. Yeah. That neck injury was legit enough to he can't go back. Raw this week, we watched it. I watched it. You said you watched it, right? Roman Reigns came back, whooped Triple H's ass. Undertaker was there.
Mm-hmm. Just doing more of...
Nothing.
Yeah, just like he did last time.
Sami Zayn versus Kevin Owens is gonna be a great match at WrestleMania. Mm-hmm, I can't wait for that. Ambrose did some stuff. New Day. Pretty much the thing I love most about WWE at this point is the New Day.
Yeah, it's the only thing I watch Raw for.
They're and my favorite thing.
They're really smart about it. They put them up real close to the beginning.
Yeah.
Every time. So you can just not watch the rest of it.
They led the show off this week, which I was like, New Day leading off Raw, best thing they could
have
done.
And they're so close. I just really want them to do exactly what they need to with the New Day. I love them as heels, but they are this close. They're right on that crux where it is a perfect time to make a face turn.
They're going
to
break them up.
Because they're so popular right now, and everybody loves them, that even though they're bad guys and they're doing bad things, people are still cheering for them. That is that perfect point to do the turn.
Well, it depends on who they put them up against, and it depends, because do they have a WrestleMania opponent right now? I don't think so.
Well, they're probably going to put them against the League of Nations.
Oh, God.
Because that's who they keep fighting.
Yeah.
Which is the perfect team to make a face turn.
It is, because they are horrible.
They're basically setting them up 100% for a face turn.
I hate League of Nations.
I want to say a lot of the original, WWF, and prior to that, AWA, started in Minnesota. And I feel like wrestlers probably shouldn't tour here anymore, because they always seem to die here.
Because
Mr. Perfect died here in Minneapolis.
He's from here, yeah.
Didn't the Hitman die here?
No, Bret the Hitman Hart's still alive.
He's still alive. Okay, someone else did.
Eddie Guerrero.
Okay,
In a hotel room in Minneapolis. And there's been a couple other ones, too.
Yeah.
Yeah, no, it's not WWE's favorite city to come to, I think, just because there's a lot of... Although, we need to get WrestleMania here in the new stadium, 2 years.
New Viking Stadium?
The new Viking Stadium. But I heard it's going to the Orange Bowl or something after this year. So this year's in Dallas, the 100,000-seat stadium. Mm-hmm. And then next year it's going to, fucking Florida in an outdoor stadium that holds 60,000 at most.
I'd say put it at XL.
No, Mania has to be in a giant stadium. Because they're doing it in the Jerry Dome down in Dallas, Texas this year.
Okay.
Mania happens in they did it in last year's WrestleMania took place in the brand new San Francisco 49ers stadium. Mm-hmm. So I would love to see it in the new Vikings stadium. Mm-hmm. I would
I suppose we'd need the publicity. Yeah.
Yeah. Oh, well, it'd just be good for the I mean, it's a whole week event. You know how much money that would bring just to the Twin Cities for like a week long period of time, and how many people? I mean, literally.
Yeah. Like, we care about that. We just want to be able to go to WrestleMania.
Well, that's fucking true. I mean, if WrestleMania is here, me and Brian are going. I don't care. Like, beg, borrow, steal. We're getting there.
And my roommate works at a pizzeria across the street from that stadium.
Oh, really? That would be
so we can get pizza. Exactly.
It'd be the worst place to work that week. It would literally, like, you'd want to.
Especially
you'd
pizza.
Die. Oh, yeah. Everyone's ordering pizza. Like, that's the one thing. Everyone will order in any city, like, it's pizza. All right, so WWE Minute, Rebels this week was a fucking filler episode. It was a chopper episode.
Can I say I was surprised? I thought it was going to be pretty much awful.
Yeah.
I did not mind the back and forth between the two droids in this episode.
Not horrible. It had its redeeming parts.
Let me put it this way. Some of the other filler episodes with some of the other characters,
yeah,
I liked less then I like this one.
Oh, yeah.
I was surprised at how well put together the chopper filler episode was. I was like, wow, they actually did this one not awful.
Well, everyone knows I love Chopper. So, like, for me, it was cool. Like, I was cool with the Chopper story. Like, I knew it was going to be a filler episode when I found out it was going to be a Chopper story. So I was going into it with the expectation of this is going to be a filler episode that should have some humor in it. And maybe we'll progress the story a little bit when they get to that planet at the end of the episode. Right. We'll see, which I did think they did cut two scenes from next week's episode. Now that I think about it, when they're fighting those things and the planet.
But that's it.
That's all they showed from next week's episode. Although this was kind of a letdown after the episode from 2 weeks ago. They took last week off, and the episode 2 weeks ago was all about Jedis and all about like furthering the story. And then for them to take this much of a, I feel, detour from that so close to the end of the season is another, I think, point to why maybe Rebels shouldn't be 22 episodes long per season. Because with them having to stretch the seasons out longer, and I get it's on a kids' channel, it's on Disney XD, whatever, but there's been too many episodes that almost didn't need to be there or could have been parts
cut
of other
no
episodes. Yeah, you know what I mean?
Because, yeah.
I mean, I feel like there's almost two seasons happening. There's, like, the seasons where, like, there's one season where, like, all the episodes with, like, Ahsoka and, like, the furthering of the story, the brother and the sister, the Inquisitors. And then there's all these other, like, side ones.
Well, it doesn't help they separate everyone out of the Ahsoka and them story, you know, so it's only the Jedi.
It feels separate. It almost feels like two separate stories running in this season. Because it's like, wait a minute, why is everyone together running these missions when that crazy stuff just happened? And no one's talking about the crazy shit that just happened. Like, am I missing something here? Like,
now I don't know the series at all.
This was your first time you ever saw it.
Yeah, but I am a preschool teacher, so it's like sort of like it's on a children's network, so that's it's like a double edged sword. So the writers can either take it seriously, but then it might reach a point where the watching audience, it's over their head, and a lot of these children just like to see the characters. Now, I'll watch Disney movies from, like, even the 90s, 80s, and they're telling Shakespearean, you know, tales. Like, Lion King is Hamlet, basically.
Right. Yep.
You know what I mean? But you're just seeing a lion frolicking around with a warthog and singing
Hakuna
Matata.
But that's what gives them staying power.
Well, it's what...
We'll always remember Lion King, but some of these...
It's what Pixel did. Like, they honed it. They made it... They found a way to make silly characters, but storylines that adults could, like, sit through. So, like...
Well, not just adults, but kids can keep watching them forever.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? It's the reason that so many kids or people in our generation are like, my kids are going to grow up on, you know, Lion King and all of these other ones instead of moving to just straight the new stuff.
The Pixar ones. Yeah.
So it's really, like, the characters that they fall in love with. So it's like, you know, we all love Aladdin, you know? And they made sequels and sequels and sequels, but that wasn't for, like, a broad audience.
Right.
Those are straight to TV or, like, straight to video.
Straight to VHS back in those days.
Yeah, so, like, but you had your characters, you know? So kids could watch that and parents could throw that in, but they weren't... But just the original that people were like, okay, that was geared towards both audiences.
Yeah.
So I feel like those filler episodes are sort of like to get the kids back in.
No, yeah. I see that part. I see that part for sure. Oh, real quick. I got one thing on here I could not say. So we've been talking about the Killing Joke animated for God knows how long. And we've said that Hamill and Conroy are going to do it. Mark Hamill's coming back as Joker, Kevin Conroy as Batman. But no one's ever confirmed mm-hmm. it. It finally got confirmed this week, which everyone's new because I think Hamill put it on his own fucking Twitter account. So it's not like it's been a secret.
Right.
But there was a first look. I think it was just like a picture or a still. So maybe I'll pull that and put it up. Maybe. See what I feel like. So, what else we got? That's it. That's the list. That's everything.
Do we want to talk some anime?
We do want to talk some anime. Yes, that was the list. Anime Spotlight is the last thing. You have some anime with you?
I do.
All right.
Just one moment.
So, 1 second as he grabs that.
Well, he's grabbing that. Super quick gamer news. Xbox, if anyone has an Xbox One, Microsoft is trying to connect it. So basically, PlayStation 4, they'll have cross-game compatibility. Yep. And Sony basically said, we'd consider working with people. They didn't specifically say Microsoft, so yeah. Who knows what's going on with that.
I heard that.
But
yeah, I heard that.
That's happening.
That's huge news. They're talking about maybe PC, Xbox,
they already have PC and PlayStation, and Xbox is guaranteed doing that now.
Wow.
So now the big rift is Xbox and PlayStation because competitors.
I said they said that they were going to do that. Or Xbox will let PlayStation, but PlayStation
Xbox
let,
specifically said
they'll let PlayStation.
We would totally be cool with doing cross compatibility with PlayStation, but PlayStation said we would totally be cool with people who approached us and wanted to do cross compatibility. So they never specifically said
Xbox.
I
thought I read something where
it's one of those things where it's very. Everybody keeps saying they'll do stuff, but till it happens. It is what it is. You know what I mean? Yeah. It's just like the Mark Hamill playing the character or whatever. It wasn't confirmed, right. But we all just assumed. That's where it is right now, is that okay. We assume but not confirm.
All right. So you got a whole bunch of anime.
Holy, this is going to be like
I'm just going to gloss epic. Over a few just because, like, I mean, I grew up on anime in the early 2000s, late 1990s. So I kind of wanted to go through a few genres. I'd say the first movie, I mean, because I saw anime when I was in middle school, mm-hmm. whatever, and it was like cool, blood, whatever, it was gory, it was, you know, Ninja Scroll, etc., Akira. I'd say visually and like, just in terms of storyline, Vampire Hunter D Bloodlust was the thing that hooked me the most.
I just recently watched that, like within the last...
this one?
Yeah.
Oh, and let me just clarify here. Johnny is a man who loves anime.
I wear it on my sleeve.
I was just going to say that. This guy has legit anime tattoos, nerd cred solidified for good. Like, that's done right there. So this is why he's speaking on anime tonight. We all know how I love anime. So when I met, that's kind of why we ended up on the show, is because this dude loves anime probably more than I love anime. And I was like, hell yeah, we need to get this dude to talk some anime. So that's why we're talking anime. So let's go back.
Like, Vampire Hunter D Bloodlust is considered, like, the original Vampire Hunter D is your typical, like, stereotypical, like, what people would say about a horror anime. It's got tentacles, raping girls,
right.
Like, tentacle monsters, all that crap. This is, like, beautifully done. It's very subtle. There's nuances within it that you... probably watch, if you watch it 15 times, you'll catch on to, oh shit, you know, like, and, you know, it's one of those films where it's not so hyperactive that, like, it's, they actually, what I call, do graphic masturbation, so there'll be scenes where they just show D on a horse, mm-hmm. walking along a canyon, etc., and they just are showing, like, their animation skills, and... In all honesty, I love the quiet, fucking strong, silent type character, like main and lead. So D is my guy. Same reason why I love Cowboy Bebop.
Yes.
Where you have Spike Spiegel.
Spike Spiegel.
My favorite English dub actor, Stephen Bloom. He's amazing. He also plays Mugen from Samurai Champloo. Probably one of my most favorite in terms of animation. Even though people think of it as just like an animation, just like it's just like an acid trip, but Fooly Cooly.
Yeah.
Fooly Cooly, if you watch all six episodes, it each scene references a different animation style throughout even the 50s, 60s, throughout the 2000s. So you'll find a South Park reference on top of a Bugs Bunny reference, on top of a Roadrunner reference, on top of a Waking Life reference, on top of a Mickey Mouse reference. But it's just manic. It's one of those storylines that I took me like 4 months on message boards back in 2004 to actually understand what's happening, that they compacted into just 2 hours of content. But it's a beautiful anime. It's what I dedicated my whole arm to. And Haru Haru Haruko is probably my dream woman. So that, and it's also the first anime that was made before the manga. So they made a manga
afterwards.
It changes the storyline in the manga. So it's not like you're reading what you just saw. It's actually a different story, a different ending, etc. My favorite love story is Saikano. It takes place in World War II Japan. It's a high school love story, but it turns out his girlfriend, who's very quiet and very subtle, very shy, is also she's a weapon for the army to battle, I would assume, America. But and ultimately, it becomes like a tragic story where he's, no spoiler, he's left behind with just her memory. I really like psychological dramas, whether it be post-apocalyptic or just kind of a mind fuck.
You ever seen Requiem from the Darkness?
Yes.
Oh, that one's that anime is a mind fuck.
Mm-hmm.
Like that anime, I was telling, were we talking about that anime? Mm-hmm. And I was like, you need to watch this shit. I think I did a spotlight on it one time, mm-hmm. didn't I? Yeah, that anime is fucked. That's one of those, like, every episode of that is like a psychological mind fuck. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? Especially like some, like the, I always think of the Willow episode, where it's like the dude who dresses up as the girl and he just keeps killing his wives, mm-hmm. dressed up as a woman. Like just the psychology behind some of those episodes.
Well, I mean, even just that storyline reminds me of Perfect Blue.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so it's the idea, like, you don't know who the killer is, and it turns out to be, well, I'm not going to say whom, but, you know, it's kind of dated in the sense that, like, the internet was very new at that time, etc. It's sort of like, one of my, you know, and I have her on my arm three times, Lane, Serial Experiments Lane, where she's actually a computer program.
Mm-hmm.
It predates The Matrix about 10 years, but it's very, very similar. But it makes references to, like, the Cheshire Cat in Alice in Wonderland, and it makes references to so many different, like, I wouldn't say pop references, but cultural references, in a way, but it's set in a setting whereas she's in the what they call the Wired, but she's not, see, it's dissimilar to The Matrix in the sense that Neo can be in The Matrix and then be in the real world.
Right.
Whereas when she's in the Wired, she can be 8, 9, 10 different people, and her in the real world is unconscious of the fact of those other characters, so she'll run into people and they know her from something. They're like, oh, you're the DJ at the club, or you're this folk singer. And she's like, I don't know what you're talking about.
Because there's a disconnect between the person inside. Correct. And outside.
But okay. The cool thing about Lane was they made the anime, and then he made a very expansive art novel showing, because you don't see her in The Matrix. You just hear people reference her as, oh, you were the DJ last night.
Okay.
And then he made an extensive art book of her as all the different characters they reference.
Crazy.
So it's yeah, it's, I mean, it's,
that's deep.
Yeah.
That's deep. What's that? And that one's Lane? Is that, yep. L-A-I-N?
Yep.
Yep.
Serial Experience Lane. Same, yep. Same director, Yoshitoshi Abe, did Haibane Renmei, which was my first anime tattoo. That one, it's really, I mean, it's not like some crazy action by any means. It's more of like a, not psychological, it's more of a, it's basically the story of a girl who ends up in limbo. She doesn't understand where she is. She grows a pair of wings, she gets a halo, and she lives within the city. And what turns out is all the girls who are Haibane are girls who killed themselves. So you learn each Haibane's story about why and how they killed themselves.
Oh, okay.
And then probably one of my favorite comedy anime is Abenobashi Magic Shopping. Well, they call it a shopping street, but you know, it's a shopping mall. But it's kind of like they make references in each episode. They time travel within the shopping arcade. So the first episode is referencing Dragon Warrior for the NES.
Okay.
You know what I'm saying? Yeah, yeah, yeah. So like, it's just like these really, really deep cuts. And if you're like a hardcore nerd about that kind of shit and gaming and movies and anime, you get like, but it's so subtle that you're like, oh, you know, you get it. Right. And it's just kind of one of those things where it's like, once, if you get it, you tell your friends, no, this is this. And you end up going through this wormhole of like trying to show them like how this relates to this. And all. It's fun. And it's the same people who did Evangelion.
Okay. Yeah.
Yep.
Magic so, Shopping Street. No way.
Abenobashi.
Abenobashi. Abenobashi.
13 episodes.
Check this one out, people. I'm gonna be checking this one out for sure.
Oh, and then also Paranoia Agent. That one's just fucking crazy. It's
Yeah, I've seen that one.
You've seen it? Yeah.
Paranoia Agent is some twisted shit.
It's twisted. It's one of those where you don't know really where it's going, and at the end you're like, I don't know where we just went.
Right. No, that I hadn't seen this one in a while. I didn't know you had this with you. This one, I saw this in.
It's a little slugger, man.
How am I gonna put this? I seen this in an extremely altered state at one point. That's the nicest way I can put it.
You don't even have to be in one, and you'll put you in.
No, I know. That's why I was like, yeah. So watch this one,
just
people.
Just the opening theme will blow your mind.
It's got I still have nightmares.
So yeah, those are my those are the ones I brought.
That's our
with
anime
me.
Spotlight. It was a bunch. I'll try to throw up some pictures as he's talking, because I know you guys can't see the DVDs and stuff like that. But I'll try to throw up some screenshots and stuff for you guys. Maybe I'll grab a couple snaps of his tattoos so I can pop those up so you guys can see them too, because they're pretty dope, especially the. I could see when I met this dude, he was on stage doing his comedy thing, and I literally legit noticed the Mugen on your arm.
Oh, Mugen,
yeah. Yeah, that was like, because I was looking at him, like, that looked like Mugen from Samurai Champloo. And that was before you had said these are anime tattoos. And I was like, I swear to God, this motherfucker's got anime tattoos. I'm like, if he does, he's fucking awesome. And then he's like, yeah, I got anime tattoos. And I was like, fuck yes. I was so happy.
I saw you light up.
I did. I was like, ooh, what? Oh, anime? I'm in it. No,
I just got my Soul Eater tattoo. It's still healing, so it looks like garbage. But
yeah, no, he's got some sick work. So I'll grab a couple snaps and stuff. We'll throw it up. But yeah, we want to thank Johnny for coming on the show for sure. Appreciate it. Anywhere you're going to be here recently or upcoming?
I'm doing 3 nights in Nebraska. So if you want to take a road trip,
or if you're in Nebraska.
Hit me up on Facebook. No, I don't have anything locally in Minneapolis or St. Paul, but I'm usually on the road with a great comic named Kevin Kraft. You can find him at Kevin Kraft Comedy on Facebook. I'm Johnny Athmann on Facebook, Athmann, two N's. And then I'm on Twitter at JohnnyAthmann.com or at Johnny Athmann.
Yeah, so. And then you got a website too, right?
Oh yeah, I have a podcast. My friend Jeffrey Talberg and I typically interview comics, but sometimes we'll do a serious episode and I'll interview. I did an interview with a gal I've been friends with for a long time, suffering from a severe eating disorder, and she really wanted to talk about it. So we talked for about an hour and a half, and it's not the funniest episode, but I'll sprinkle in a little quips in there. But it's a serious problem that she was suffering from, still is. It's always a struggle. I talked to my friend Matt, I'm not going to say his last name, before and after he went into rehab. But often we just talk to comics, or Jeffrey and I will just talk and
just do your
shoot
thing.
The shit. Yeah.
Yeah, so check out his podcast. It's
This Drug Called Life podcast.com.
This Drug Called Life podcast.com.
Go you check it out. Lost it.
I did minute. Not even for a second. Fuck you, Brian. Oh.
Hey, I haven't been mean to you for a while.
No, you haven't. I miss you too, by the way. It's not the same without you.
Every time you say 50th episode come out up, I'm like, I use that joke too much. I can't. Years old. I held back.
Hey, I got a long time before I'm hitting 50. I'm looking young.
So another year or something.
I'm going to kill him after this show. He might not be
brought
back.
Brought it back.
So
you know what else? Speaking of things coming back, the mustache is coming back.
Oh my
back.
God, thank you. Boom. Thank you. Mustache coming back, people. The mustache is coming back. Who knows? Maybe I'll even
You should.
No. I spent 34 years of not growing anything.
Really? Yeah, I can't. I still don't grow facial hair on the side of my face. So, you know, I'm going to hit puberty eventually, though, and maybe I'll let my mustache grow. That's it. That's the show. Basement Boy Banter, episode 49. That's a wrap. Hit us up on Facebook, everywhere else. Brian, Thor, Johnny, deuces. That's it.
Deuce.
If you like what you just saw, make sure you subscribe to our YouTube channel, like our videos, follow us on Twitter and Instagram, and like our Facebook page.